Imagine that I go to the doctor and he diagnoses my problem and gives me some medicine. Tells me to take it faithfully. Then imagine I don't take the medicine, I don't do what the doctor tells me to. Would you say I had faith in that doctor or I didn't have much faith? How much trust and confidence would you say I had in that doctor? Well, today a lot of people say they have faith and trust in God and the Bible and Jesus, but they're not really doing what God tells them to. How much faith do they really have? Today's program is on God's tests of faith. Stay tuned.
The Churches of Christ of the North Texas area present The Truth in Love.
How precious is the book divine by inspiration given. Bright as a lamp is grace that shines to guide my soul to heaven. Holy Bible, book divine, precious treasure, thou art mine. Light to my feet and a light to my way to guide me safely home. It sweetly cheers my drooping heart in this dark veil of tears. Light my life is filled in parts and quells my rising fears. Holy Bible, book divine, precious treasure, thou art mine. Lamp to my feet and a light to my way to guide me safely home.
Good morning and welcome to The Truth in Love. I'm your host, David Roper. Our thanks for being with us today, and a special thanks to those of you that have been sending us your questions. Lord willing, we're going to have a special question and answer session next week, and your questions are still welcome for that. Today's speaker is Bobby Duncan from Birmingham, Alabama. In addition to preaching for the Adamsville Church of Christ in Greater Birmingham, Mr. Duncan is editor of the publication Words of Truth. He'll be speaking to us on God's tests of faith right after this next song.
Will your anchor hold in the storms of life when the clouds unfold their wings of strife? When the storm tides lift and the cables strain, will your anchor drift or firm remain? We have an anchor that keeps our soul steadfast and sure while the billows roll. Fastened to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love. It is safely moored till the storm will stand, for it is well secured by the Savior's hand. And the cables fast from his heart to mine can defy the blast through strength divine. We have an anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure while the billows roll. Fastened to the rock which cannot move, rounded firm and deep in the Savior's love. When our eyes behold through the gathering night the city of gold, our harbor bright, we shall anchor fast by the heavenly shore, with the storms all past forevermore. We have an anchor that keeps our soul steadfast and sure while the billows roll. Fastened to the rock which cannot move, rounded firm and deep in the Savior's love.
In James 1:13, the inspired writer says, "Let no man say when he's tempted, I'm tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man." It might be somewhat surprising to the casual Bible reader to read then in Genesis chapter 22 this statement. "Now it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham." Does the Bible contradict itself? One passage says that God tempteth no man, and then another says that God did tempt Abraham. Well, of course, the truth of the matter is, words do not always mean the same thing. The word tempt has more than one meaning. The word tempt sometimes means to subdue evil. That's precisely how James uses the word in James 1:13. God does not solicit any man to do evil. But the word tempt also means to test, or to prove, or to try. And this is the sense in which it's used in Genesis 22:1, where the Bible says that God did tempt Abraham. God gave Abraham the opportunity to prove or to demonstrate his faithfulness and his loyalty to God. Fact that down through the history of God's dealings with man, God has always had certain tests. He has always given mankind the opportunity to demonstrate or to prove his faithfulness, his loyalty to God. I hope in our lesson at this time, I will be able to impress you with the significance, the importance of God's tests of our faith. In order to appreciate fully these tests, I think we must understand that the commands of God fall into two different categories. Some of the commands are commands that we would refer to as moral commands of God. Other commands are what we would refer to as arbitrary commands of God. Now, a moral command is something which God has commanded because it's right. It's right in the very nature of the case. For example, God said, "Thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not commit adultery," and so forth. Now, why did God say, "Thou shalt not kill"? Well, we can see why. We can understand that. We have no difficulty in seeing that it would be wrong to kill even if God hadn't said it. Wrong to commit adultery. Wrong to steal. These are matters that are moral in nature. These things constitute an essential part of society. We could not be a civilized people if we did not recognize certain moral principles. And so we can say that a moral command of God is something which God commanded because it was right or wrong, as the case may be, in the very nature of the case itself. Now, we think about the Ten Commandments as being a moral code, and indeed it is, but we need to remember that the morality which is stipulated in the Ten Commandment law did not begin when God gave the law of Moses or gave the Ten Commandments at Mount Sinai. It was already wrong for a man to murder before the Ten Commandment law was given. It was already wrong for one to commit adultery or to steal before the Ten Commandment law was given. Well, if that's the case, then why did God say, "Thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not commit adultery"? In Romans 7 and 13, the Apostle Paul gives us an answer to this. He says that it was to impress upon us the exceeding sinfulness of sin. Or in other words, to let us know something about the nature of sin. It is conceivable that a person might be guilty of a number of violations of God's will without ever really realizing how terrible it is to violate God's will. Let me illustrate it for you. Let's suppose that a man lives out in some rural area of your state, and he drives his pickup truck around on his farm and on the backcountry roads, but he never has driven in a city like Fort Worth. Now, if this man were to decide to drive, there's a good chance that he would become guilty of a number of violations of the traffic laws. And were he to do so, he might never know it. He might violate a number of laws without ever realizing it. On the other hand, if before he came into the city, he should write and request a copy of the traffic regulations for the city of Fort Worth, and then familiarize himself with those regulations, and then come into the city and drive, he might still be guilty of violating the law, but in this case, he would be aware of it. Now, the law of Moses helped man, according to Paul's statement in Romans 7, to become aware of the fact that he stood in need of God's forgiveness. It helped man to realize that he had violated God's law. But again, I say that when God gave the Ten Commandment law at Mount Sinai, it was not by the giving of that moral code that certain things became right or wrong. No, God gave commands with respect to these things because they were already right or wrong. But now, contrast with that, those commands of God that we would refer to as the arbitrary commands of God. Certain things which God has commanded have no rhyme or reason so far as we are able to see. These are things which are right because God commanded them. Remember, the moral command of God is something that God commanded because it's right. The arbitrary command of God is something that is right because God commanded it. And it became right when God commanded it. Let me illustrate it for you. In the 12th chapter of the book of Exodus, the children of Israel were in Egyptian bondage. God had sent Moses to be their deliverer. And by the hand of Moses, God had sent 9 plagues upon the people of Egypt to convince them that they should let the children of Israel go free. They did not let the children of Israel go free. The 10th plague was about to come upon them. The 10th plague involved the death of the firstborn in every household. How were the Israelites going to escape this? God gave them a plan that involved an arbitrary command of God. God said, "Take a lamb of the first year, a male without blemish. Kill that lamb. Take the blood of that lamb and sprinkle it upon the lintels and the doorpost of your houses." And God said, "When I see that blood upon the doors and the lintels of the houses, then I will not smite the firstborn in the houses of the Israelites." Those houses where I see that blood. The Israelites did that. Can you imagine what they must have been thinking as they were killing the lamb and as they were sprinkling the blood of that lamb on the doorpost, the lintels of their houses? No doubt some of them were raising the question, how can sprinkling the blood of a lamb on the doorpost, the side post, and the lintels of the doors possibly have anything to do with sparing the lives of the firstborn in these houses? No doubt some may have reasoned this way, well, if God wants to do so, He can spare the lives of the firstborn in houses that do not sprinkle blood on the doorposts and the lintels of their houses. Oh, but this was a test of their faith. Here is something that they did for one reason and one reason only. The reason being, because God said do it. Not because it was morally right or morally wrong to do it or not to do it. But it became the right thing to do when God said do it, because God said do it. Now this is one of the things that makes an arbitrary command. The fact that from a human standpoint, we can see no connection between the thing which is commanded and the blessing which is promised. The blessing to be received was the sparing of the firstborn. The thing commanded was the sprinkling of the blood. Can you see any connection between those two? I can't, except God said do it and you'll receive the blessing. Another example of an arbitrary command of God is found in 2 Kings, the 5th chapter. In this Old Testament account, the Bible tells about a man who was a captain in an army of one of the nations that was actually an enemy to the nation of Israel. They'd gone into battle with the Israelites. A little Israelitish maid had been taken captive and was the household servant in the house of Naaman, this captain. But Naaman, the Bible says, was a leper. He had the dread disease, leprosy. This little maid was overheard to say to her mistress, "Would to God my master were with the prophet that is in Israel." And she said that the prophet in Israel would be able to heal him of his leprosy. Well, Naaman wanted to be healed of his leprosy, and so he immediately made a journey into the land of Israel. He made the mistake of going to the king of Israel, who was disturbed by his coming, but eventually found his way down to the house of the prophet in Israel, made it known to him that he wanted to be cleansed of his leprosy. Now, the prophet of God on this occasion did something that I'm sure we would consider quite strange. He simply sent his messenger out to Naaman, and he said to Naaman, "Go and wash in Jordan 7 times, and you'll be cleansed of your leprosy." Now, that's a strange command. Can you see any connection between washing in Jordan 7 times and being cleansed of leprosy? Friends, I honestly cannot. But this is what God, through His prophet, told Naaman to do. Naaman would have to wash in Jordan 7 times if he was to be cleansed of his leprosy. At first, Naaman did not like this command of God. He went away in a rage. It seems that he was determined not to do what the prophet of God had told him to do. Why? Number one, he could see no connection between the command which had been given to him and the desired blessing. But in the second place, what had been commanded him on this occasion was actually repulsive to Naaman. Naaman said, "Are not the rivers of Damascus, Abana, and Pharpah far better than all of the waters in the land of Israel? If that's the way that I'm going to be cleansed of my leprosy, then I should wash in one of those rivers instead of the River Jordan." Ah, but God had said through His prophet, "Go and wash in Jordan 7 times. Now, question, was it right for Naaman to wash in Jordan 7 times? It was. Why? Because God commanded it. When did it become right for Naaman to wash in Jordan? When God commanded it. Can you see any connection between washing in Jordan and being cleansed of leprosy? The only connection I see, my friends, is that God commanded that Naaman wash in Jordan and promised, if he would do so, that he would be cleansed of his leprosy. Naaman then, after a conversation with one of his own servants who persuaded him to obey the command of God, went down to the Jordan River, washed in the River Jordan once, twice, and on up until 7 times. When he had washed 7 times, he was completely cleansed of his leprosy. One other example of an arbitrary command of God, a command which becomes right because God commanded it, is this 22nd chapter of the book of Genesis, to which we referred in the outset of our lesson. God did tempt Abraham, and he said to him, "Abraham." Abraham said, "Here am I." And God said, "Take now thy son, thine only son, even Isaac whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, unto a mountain that I will tell thee of, and offer him there as a burnt offering upon one of the mountains that I will show thee." And Abraham obeyed God. He arose early the next morning, saddled his ass, took 2 young men with him, took Isaac his son, carried some wood with him, made his journey into the land of Moriah, and then went with Isaac, leaving the servants behind, to the top of the mountain, and there built an altar upon which to offer his son Isaac. Why? Because God said it. Was it right? Would it have been right for Abraham to offer Isaac as a burnt offering the day before God commanded it? No. Such would have been murder. Such would have been a terrible sin. But when God commanded it, it became right. Friends, this is the nature of the arbitrary commands of God. A command is an arbitrary command if we can see no reason why God gave the command, if we can see no apparent connection between the thing commanded and the blessing promised. Now, an arbitrary command might also be very repulsive in its very nature, as was the case with the command to Naaman. And an arbitrary command of God might even involve something that would be wrong under ordinary circumstances, but something which becomes right when God commands it, as in the case of Abraham's offering Isaac his son. Now, of course, in the case of Abraham, you will recall that God prevented his actually killing his son when Abraham demonstrated his faith. He demonstrated his loyalty to God by going as far as God would allow him to go in actually offering his son Isaac as a burnt offering. I submit to you that God's test of man's faith are not in connection with the moral commands of God. Well, there are many people who make no effort whatsoever to please God, and yet who live in harmony with the moral commands of God. They do not become guilty of stealing or lying or cheating or committing adultery or murder. And yet they're making no effort to please God. Some even who are atheists live in harmony with these commands. We cannot say that this proves that one is pleasing to God. We cannot say that these demonstrate one's faithfulness to God. A man might live in harmony with the moral principles of God's commands, who does not even believe in God, and yet he does so simply to maintain his self-respect, perhaps to maintain his respect in the community where he lives, or maybe because he's simply by nature a law-abiding citizen. But it is in connection with the arbitrary commands of God that one demonstrates his faithfulness and his loyalty to God. Why, for example, would Abraham offer Isaac other than because God said so? Why would Naaman dip in Jordan other than the fact that God said do it? Why would the Israelites sprinkle blood upon the doorposts and the lintels of their houses other than the fact that God said do that? When one obeys an arbitrary command of God, he demonstrates his faithfulness and his loyalty unto God. The old pioneer preachers used to illustrate this by a story that they told about a family that lived over on the eastern seaboard of the United States back during the days when Kentucky was a wilderness. They said the father of this family went down into Kentucky and staked out a piece of ground where he was planning to move the family. He went back home, drew a rough plot, a rough sketch of the ground, and on that plot he located the spot where a house was to be built, a spot where a barn was to be built, and a spot where the well was to be dug. And then he gave this piece of paper to his oldest son and said, "Go down and find the ground, build the house, build the barn, and dig the well, and then send for the family and we'll come down." As the story goes, the son went down, carried the piece of paper with him, located the property, found the place where the house was to be built, looked around and said, "Oh, what good judgment my father has used. This is certainly the best place to build a house." And so he constructed the house. Again, he consulted his piece of paper, found the place where the barn was to be built, looked around again and said, "This is certainly the right place for the barn. My dad certainly used wisdom in this." And so he erected the barn. Once again, he consulted his diagram and found the place where the well was to be dug. But as he looked over the situation, he shook his head and he said, "My dad's made a mistake." And he could think of a number of reasons why the well should not be in this particular place. There was a much better place, one that he knew would be far better than this one selected by his dad. And so that's where he dug the well. The pioneer preachers would tell that story, and then they would say, in how many cases did this son obey his father? 2 out of 3? No. The son did not obey his father at all. You see, he built the house where he thought it should be built. He built the barn where he thought it should be built. He dug the well where he thought it should be dug. Friends, it makes no difference how many hundreds of people tell me to do a thing. If I think from my own human reasoning and observation that that's the thing to be done, I don't do it because they've told me to do it, but because it makes sense to me. If God tells me to do a thing and I examine the situation and decide it appeals to my intelligence, it commends itself to my thinking, and do it for that reason, then I don't do it because God said it. For that reason, God has given His people arbitrary commands. God has said, do a certain thing, and in connection with these arbitrary commands, the thing to be done is something that does not commend itself to one's intelligence, but something that one will do only because God said it. It is in connection with the arbitrary commands of God that the religious world in which we live stumbles. The Bible teaches that alien sinners must believe the gospel in order to be saved. So far as I know, all religious people believe that practically. Why? Well, it's just reasonable that if Jesus is going to save us, we'll have to believe in Him. The Bible clearly teaches that people must repent of sins in order to be saved. And everybody believes that. Why? Well, it makes sense. If the Lord's going to save me from my sins, certainly I must repent and turn away from my sins. On the other hand, the Bible teaches that one must confess Christ in order to be saved. And everybody agrees to that. Why? Well, that makes sense too, doesn't it? But when we come to the command to be baptized, the religious world says, no, that's not necessary. Why? Well, is it because the Bible doesn't say very much about it? The Bible mentions baptism more than it mentions repentance. That's not it. Is it because what the Bible says is difficult of understanding with reference to baptism? No, that's not it either. What the Bible says concerning baptism, it sets forth largely in words of one syllable. Then why does the religious world reject this command of God? Because it is an arbitrary command. Because as we look at the command, we cannot see any reason why God gave it. This is the thing that makes it a test of our faith. We obey God when we do what God says because God said it in the way that God said it.
Trying to walk in the steps of the Savior, trying to follow our Savior and King, shaping our lives by His blessed example. Happy, how happy the songs that we breathe. How beautiful to walk in the steps of the Savior, stepping in the light, stepping in the light. How beautiful to walk in the steps of the Savior. More closely to Him who is leading when we are tempted to turn from the way, trusting the arm that is strong to defend us. Happy, how happy our praises each day. How beautiful to walk in the steps of the Savior, stepping in the light, stepping in the light. How beautiful to walk in the steps of the Savior, letting pass of light. Trying to walk in the steps of the Savior, upward, still upward, we'll follow our guide. When we shall see Him, the King in His beauty, happy, how happy our place at His side. How beautiful to walk in the steps of the Savior, stepping in the light, stepping in the light. How beautiful to walk in the steps of the Savior, letting paths of light.
Our thanks to Bobby Duncan for being with us and bringing us this very basic Bible lesson. If you'd like a copy of this lesson, we'll send you an outline of the material plus an audio cassette. Just send us your name and address. We'll send these free and without obligation. Now, while you're writing, you may also want to ask for your free copy of a special booklet on prayer. Hugo McCord will be bringing a special series of lessons on prayer in just a few weeks. And this booklet will enable you to study along with him there in your own home. And don't forget that next week we'll have the question and answer session. We hope to see you then.
This has been The Truth in Love, sponsored by the Churches of Christ of the North Texas area. For a copy of today's program, additional information, or Bible correspondence course at no charge to you, please write The Truth in Love, Post Office Box 865, Hearst, Texas 76053. Once again, write The Truth in Love, Post Office Box 865, Hearst, Texas 76053. We invite you to attend the Church of Christ in your area. Join us again next Sunday at the same time for The Truth in Love.